I will like to request Aparna if you can answer the queries that are in the chat box. And we move on to the next panel. And I would like to invite Dr. Ruby Puragohain to share her case. Dr. Ruby is a well-known radiologist. She's passionate about fetal medicine and she is attached to Ecopath Center in Guwahati. But we all know her because she has been a faculty in many IRI conferences. And I hand it over to you, Dr. Ruby. Please share your case.
Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is. Yes.
Thank you for that kind introduction, Mohit sir. So very good evening to my respected teachers, seniors, colleagues, and my dear friends. So at the very outset, I'd like to thank SFM for giving me the opportunity to present a case on this prestigious platform. So I'll be presenting three cases of hypoplastic left heart syndrome. The main emphasis is on importance of early detection and then counseling. So this was a 32-year-old Gravida 2 para 1 from a non-consanguineous marriage. With a 3-year-old living child, she was referred for her second trimester anomaly scan due to an abnormal 4-chamber view of the heart. Her first trimester scan done elsewhere was reported to be normal and was corresponding with her LNP. However, no combined test was done at that time. She didn't have any history of diabetes, hypertension, or any other significant disease. The biometric measurements now corresponded to 24 weeks gestation. So that is the 4-chamber view in systole and diastole, where we can see that the left-sided heart chambers are very, very small. That is the left atria, which is very small. And that's the left middle, which is so small that it's not even visible. And we can also see that there is normal closure and opening of the tricuspid valve during systole and diastole. So that's the 4-chamber view with color Doppler image, where you can just see one inflow there, that is the flow across the tricuspid valve, whereas no flow can be seen across the mitral valve. And that's the spectral Doppler at the tricuspid valve, which shows normal flow pattern without any evidence of tricuspid regurgitation. And this is a video clip, which is again showing that normal flow can be seen across the tricuspid valve, whereas absolutely no flow can be seen across the mitral valve. And this is the three vessel trachea view without color and with color, where we can see that the aortic arch is very, very narrow and the pulmonary artery looks a little dilated. And the color Doppler image here shows there is reversal of flow at the aortic arch. So based on these ultrasound findings, this case was diagnosed as hypoplastic left heart syndrome. No other structural anomaly was detected. The patient was counseled regarding the prognosis and amniocentesis was advised, which they declined. So they were from a peripheral small town and they left without doing any further test. And I, when I took a follow-up a few months later, I was informed that the baby died just 2 hours after birth. Two other cases which were detected in the first trimester and early second trimester. This one was a 25-year-old primi gravida, non-consanguineous marriage without any significant medical history. She came for a routine first trimester scan. Her early dating scan, which was done at 7 weeks, which is done elsewhere, was unremarkable. And now CRL corresponded to 12 weeks and 4 days gestation. So in this fetus, we can see that there is a grossly increased nuchal thickness. We can also see there's grossly, there's generalized cutaneous edema, and also there is bilateral pleural effusion. So this particular fetus is already showing hydrops. And that's the 4-chamber view where we can see just 2 chambers. That's the right atrium and right ventricle, and left-sided chambers are so small that they are not even visible. And the color Doppler image at the level of 4-chamber, we are seeing just 1 inflow there. And this is the three vessel with color Doppler showing just presence of one great artery by the side of the SVC, that's the pulmonary artery. And also spectral Doppler is showing some tricuspid regurgitation. The third case is a 36-year-old gravida 4 para 1 with one living child and history of two spontaneous miscarriages at first trimester. There's history of third degree consanguineous marriage. No prior scan was done. She came for her first scan at 15 weeks. Her LMP date was corresponding with biometry. So that's the four-chamber view in this fetus. And in this particular case, we now see that the left ventricle here is not very small or atretic. Instead, we are looking at a left ventricle which looks little dilated, globular in shape, and we can also see some echogenicity on the wall of the left ventricle. And that's the mitral valve, which looks very thick and echogenic. And then color Doppler is showing that no flow can be seen across that thickened mitral valve. And this is the three vessel view where we are just seeing two vessels. That's the pulmonary artery and SVC. The aorta should be somewhere here, which is not even seen. And that's the video clip, which shows again the same finding of normal flow across the tricuspid valve and completely absence of flow across the mitral valve. So both these later two cases, they opted to go for termination of pregnancy without doing any further invasive test. So that's the biggest difficulty we face in our day-to-day practice. Whenever we detect any major structural anomaly and we do suggest some amniocentesis or invasive testing, the thing that those tests are usually unnecessary because they'll be going for termination anyway. So here I think we have a role to play to change the mindset of people or the clinical scenario by doing a proper counseling, because even this particular anomaly can be associated with certain chromosomal anomalies, most commonly Turner's, trisomy 13 and 18, and can also be associated with certain genetic syndromes. However, the association is quite less when it's an isolated anomaly. Yet, this invasive testing is definitely going to help us predict the outcome for her future pregnancies. So I think our respected panelist and especially genetist Runmoni Madam is going to throw some light in this aspect. So at the end, I would just like to mention about the main ultrasound features of hypoplastic left heart syndrome. In the four chamber view, we see a very, very small left sided heart chambers. In the three vessel view, we see a very narrow aortic arch with a little bit dilated or compensatory dilatation of the pulmonary artery. And the color Doppler at the four chamber, we see just one inflow with complete absence of flow across mitral valve, or maybe just minimal flow across the mitral valve. And the color Doppler at three vessel trachea view actually clinches the diagnosis. Here we see reversal of flow at the aortic arch. Thank you very much.
The cases were wonderful, Dr. Ruby. Very crisp images. And you have documented all the signs of an HLHS. Kudos to you.
Thank you.
When you have said that the first thing, you know, when it comes to hypoplastic left heart, it's a very striking abnormality. But before we actually proceed to the panel, let me just introduce you to my panelists. And my panelists for today are Dr. Jahar Baidya. He is a professor of Department of Obstetrics of OBGYN at the Agartala Government Medical College, and he's been involved in training for almost 18 years now. We have Dr. Partha Mohan, who's a radiologist primarily, but with a special interest in fetal medicine. He's a senior consultant radiologist and fetal medicine expert at Pratiksha Hospitals, Guwahati. We have Dr. Roramani Deka. She is a professor and head of Department of Anatomy at the AIIMS Guwahati. And we have Dr. Ruhi Gupta, who is a consultant radiologist at Manipati Hospital, Pal, who is quite academically oriented. And we have Dr. Satyajit Chauhan, who is an obstetrician with a fellowship in fetal medicine from Bangalore Fetal Medicine Center. And he's also a consultant at the Pratiksha Hospitals. So, having introduced you, I would Now, start with the thing that the first thing that strikes your eye is discrepancy, a four-chamber discrepancy. So, starting with you, Dr. Rohi Gupta, I mean, when you see a small left ventricle, what do you think of in your mind? What differentials cross your mind?
Good evening, Dr. Mohit. Thank you for your question. Yes, small left ventricle. There are a few things that come up to our mind. The major pathology behind it is the poor development of the left heart. So as already Dr. Ruby has presented beautiful cases to us about hyperplastic left heart syndrome, I would not like to discuss HLHS in detail at present during the evening. Further on, other panelists would be discussing it in detail. So with small left ventricle, HLHS is one of the common things, suspicions we have. Then we also come to aortic coarctation, where we do, when we see a small left ventricle, we should, we do think about it, definitely. And but there's a differentiating point between HLHS and aortic coarctation, which is the left ventricle is not
kinetic. We'll certainly take that part later on.
Right. And then we also have the unbalanced AVSD, where the atrioventricular connection is erroneous, where the flow is mostly directed towards just one ventricle, and then the disproportion happens, and thereby we see the small ventricle. Then as DORV is there, I guess interrupted aortic arch, and Dr. Mohit, so far, right. This yes. is my list. If so you would like to have yeah. something, please.
So when you think of a small left ventricle, either it is not functioning or it is not because it's not receiving blood, you could think of the above conditions. So Dr. Partha, tell me, what exactly do you mean by hypoplastic left heart syndrome? Dr. Partha Mohan, can you unmute yourself, please?
Yeah, good evening, Dr. Mohit. Can yes. you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes, you are. Yes,
so
you are
audible. So, left heart syndrome is basically, a group of cardiac malformations involving and leading to severe underdevelopment of the left ventricle as well as the left ventricular outflow tract, and with grossly altered hemodynamics. This represents around about approximately 2 to 4% of all the cardiac anomalies. And the incidence is probably 1 is to 10,000 births. Essentially, what we see is the major apex of the heart is formed by the right ventricle in this case. We have a hypoplastic left ventricle, which is hypokinetic as well. And we have a hypoplastic aorta. Along with it, we have an atretic or stenosed aortic valve, or we have an atretic or dysplastic mitral valve. So there are two forms of hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Initially, when we have atresia of both the mitral and the aortic valves, so there's no communication between the left atrium and the left ventricle. So the left ventricle appears obliterated or severely hypoplastic. In the second form, we have atresia or stenosis of the aortic valve along with the dysplastic mitral valve, where the left ventricle might be visible, or it might appear slightly globular in shape. And we can see the mitral valve echogenicity is more echogenic in these cases.
Yeah, thank you so much. So the take home point is not all hypoplastic left ventricles will have a severely narrowed left ventricle. In some cases, you might find a left ventricle which is showing poor contractility. So right. Dr. Ruhi, again, can you just elaborate the finding that you would appreciate on B mode in a four chamber view when it concerns an HLHS?
In HLHS, in grayscale, we would, the striking part would be, the most striking feature would be disproportionate size of the left ventricle, small hypokinetic left ventricle, and the apex being predominantly taken up by the right ventricle. But then again, it is not always necessary that the left ventricle would be small, or it may be normal, it may be dilated, or it may be absent. But one thing very important there is whenever it is there in the presence of left ventricle, it is always hypokinetic in compared to the right ventricle in M mode images. The thing is, further we will find that things like aortic atresia is there. Please hold on for a second. I'm really sorry for the interruption, Doctor.
Yeah, please go ahead. No problem at all. Please go ahead. You're talking about the echogenicity of the ventricle as well.
The ventricle due to endocardial fibrolastosis. And then the foramen ovale also would be facing more towards the right ventricle, as it should be facing towards the left ventricle, but it, left atrium. But it would be facing towards the right atrium, which will cause the flow, the reversal flow of left to right shunting.
Yeah, we'll stick to the B mode now. So basically, it's the chamber asymmetry that strikes your eye.
Right.
And whenever you see an echogenic chamber, that means the ventricle is already dyskinetic, because that's the endocardial fibroelastosis stage, which is the last stage of dyskinesia. And that automatically, you know, is striking enough for the eye to pick up that one ventricle is anechoic, and the other shows a lot of calcification and echogenicity. So Dr. Paltha, what would you then expect on color when you switch it on the four chamber?
Well, four chamber view will give us initially, as I already mentioned, the apex will be primarily formed by the right ventricle. And you will have a unilateral perfusion between the right atrium and the right ventricle, whereas there would be hardly any filling in the aorta. You might get, if you're very lucky, you might get some filling in the aorta. That's all. That is in the four chamber view.
Sometimes you can have a minimal flow going across. And if the mitral valve is completely atretic, you will have absolutely no filling on the left-sided chamber. So Dr. Satyajit, would you like to use any additional views to further cement your diagnosis or confirm your diagnosis?
Yeah, hello, good evening, everyone. After the four chamber view, we'll move up, we'll see the outflow tract and we'll see the five chamber view, where the aorta might looks very small, very, very small, and the valves may look plastic, thick, echogenic. Sometimes the aorta may not be visible in the five chambers. So as you come up in the three vessel trachea view, again, in the grayscale, like we can see three vessels, we can appreciate sometimes where the aorta will looks very, very small, tubular, or sometimes it may not be seen, where instead of three vessels, we can see only two vessels. So once we put on the color, what we see that the four chamber, which has been mentioned, there will be unilateral perfusion between right atrium to right ventricle. And on the top, as you move up, there will be no anterograde flow. There will be reversal of the flow in the aorta and the aortic arch from the ductus arteriosus. That clinches the diagnosis, and that's differentiated from the critical aortic stenosis.
So can you elaborate on this duct-dependent circulation a bit for the audience, please?
Yes, duct-dependent circulation is basically, the entity is called duct-dependent systemic circulation. I'll just take you a little time. Duct-dependent systemic circulation means when the systemic circulation, normally it is maintained by the aorta. When there is any pathology in the aorta which fails to sustain the systemic circulations, either in the form of coarctation of aorta or aortic stenosis or interrupted aortic arch, all these are the cases where the systemic circulation has to be maintained by the ductus arteriosus. This is called duct-dependent circulations. And there is a very, very important significance in the sense that these cases has to be delivered in a tertiary care center under the pediatric cardiologist guidance, because the duct has to be kept. Normally, the ductus arteriosus closes within 72 hours after delivery. But in these situations where there is an aortic pathology and we want to keep the ductus open, we need to start prostaglandin infusion immediately after delivery so that ductus does not close up. And as per the pediatric cardiologists and other people, this is the most important window. Because if we miss this window, the correction of the pathology, the basically lactic acidosis and many other electrolyte changes happens in the baby, and it becomes very difficult to resuscitate the baby. That's why.
Perfect. So the prostaglandins basically keep the duct, prevent the duct from constricting, and that's what keeps the flow into the aorta. So you can actually have a small aorta in other conditions, but what we would be interested is an extension of the four chamber view. When you see a small aorta and a reversal, it actually clinches the diagnosis. In the same sitting, can you also elaborate on the importance of looking at the foramen ovale?
Yes. Initially, I'd like to start with the normal foramen of ovale. The left atrium basically receives the blood from the pulmonary veins and from the right atrium across the foramen of ovale. When their HLHS is set up, when there is a mitral atresia, the blood from the left atrium cannot go into the left ventricle. So it has to move. It creates a pressure within the left atrium, and it causes back pressure in the pulmonary veins. Also, it causes reversal of flow across the foramen of ovale. Ultimately, the right ventricles and the right atriums becomes receives more and more blood, and gradually the right ventricular afterload will increase. Gradually, there occurs restriction of flow across the foramen of ovale, blood flow across the foramen of ovale, which in further increases the left atrial pressure, because blood from the left atrium cannot move. It will cause further back pressure in the pulmonary veins, which will be reflected as reversal of A wave in the spectral Doppler. I'd like to highlight here that the venous pattern, the Doppler pattern of the pulmonary veins is almost similar as the ductus venosus, because we are very used to see the ductus venosus. The patterns are very same. So the reversal of A wave in ductus almost looks same as the pulmonary venous Doppler's abnormality, and it casts reversal in the A wave is a poor prognostic factor in a case of an HLHS.
So what we essentially is important is to document the pulmonary venous waveform, because if you have picked up an HLHS in the second trimester, late second trimester, you have no choice but to continue the pregnancy. So all you need to know is the condition worsening? So you will know the condition is worsening when you start seeing signs of increased pressure in the right atrium in the form of inverted A wave in the pulmonary vein. So always start looking for a restricted foramen ovale. Always document the pulmonary venous waveform. So Dr. Partha, How soon can you diagnose an HLHS? How early can you do that?
This is a very tricky question, actually.
Yes, it is.
So what happens is, normally we see a four-chamber view and outflow tracts, they're visualized in majority of the fetuses at 12 weeks, basically. And if you're using a transvaginal route, I think it's recommended if you're visualizing, if you want to do a scan before 12 weeks. There's certain potential risks here, because the aortic and the ductal arches, as well as the pulmonary veins, are not clearly seen in nickel scan, first trimester scan. And things like atrioventricular septum and the offset of the mitral, as well as the tricuspid valves, they may not be completely developing by 14 weeks. So we can come to a diagnosis of hypoplastic left heart syndrome by seeing the apex of the heart and obliterated left ventricle. But then I feel we should, you know, kind of follow it up closely, maybe after 14 weeks or so.
Of course, but what we normally document at the nuchal scan is always that we document two parallel inflows and we have the ball and stick appearance in the outflows. Yeah. So when you are doing that in each and every case, you might come across a case like this where you see only one inflow, and that would prompt you to probably do a transfer channel. As you rightly said, it becomes difficult with all the cases at 12 weeks, which also depends on the patient's habitus.
Exactly.
But fortunately, when you are looking at the nuchal transducer in the right position, is the same fetal position that we use for evaluating the two inflows in on the cardiac mode. So that is possible early on if you see only one inflow. And sometimes, of course, Dr. Partha, you rightly said, if you are confident enough, if you're lucky enough, you might even see changes of endocardial fibroelastosis and even aortic reversal in the 14 weeks. Of course, towards the 14th week. So can there be any associated findings, Dr. Rui? What are generally the associated findings, Dr. Rui? Are you there?
Sorry, I had forgotten to unmute. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible, Dr. Rui. Go ahead.
There are cardiac and extracardiac associations around the studies have revealed approximately about maybe chromosomal anomalies of 4 to 5%, like Turner syndrome, and associated with aortic stenosis and high risk of cystic hygromas found in Turner syndrome in thickened nuchal translucency, renal anomalies. So we would suggest a Turner syndrome in that. And then fetal growth restriction, probably because of the low cardiac output, and other syndromes like Noonan and Holt-Oram.
So, though we know that it's a minuscule risk with chromosomal abnormalities, we know that there could be syndromic associations.
Yes.
So, Dr. Partha, I mean, if I have to differentiate between the common differentials, how would you differentiate a hypoplastic left heart from the other differentials?
Basically, it's the left ventricle which you're talking about.
Yes.
So, whenever we see a small left ventricle, we think of hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Now, in coarctation of aorta, this is the closest of the differential diagnosis probably. You have a narrow LV, but the length is almost the same as RV. Now, the apex is found by the right ventricle here in thing, and coarctation of aorta, you'll find it's built by the left ventricle. As regarding contractility, in its hypoplastic left heart syndrome, you have a hypokinetic right ventricle here. And there will be LV wall echogenicity will be more, it will be hyperechoic in HLHS. Mitral flow will be definitely either absent or reduced, where it is normal in coarctation of aorta. And aortic wall will be there in coarctation of aorta. There won't be any stenosis or atresia, whereas here we might find atretic valve. And the aortic arch, it's kind of tubular or hypoplastic in case of hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Whereas coarctation of aorta, we have this contraductal shelf, which is very pathognomonic of coarctation, actually. Here in hypoplastic left heart syndrome, the systolic aortic flow will be absent, whereas in the coarctation of aorta, there will be antegrade flow. Even for that matter, even the aortic isthmus flow, you will find a reversal there in HLHS, whereas in coarctation of aorta, you might find an antegrade flow or a partial reverse flow. And finally, if you look at the foramen oval, there will be reversal of the flow in foramen in case of HLHS. And interpret aortic arch, when you see the continuity of the aortic arch, there will be sudden obliteration of the aortic arch, and you'll see that arch, that vessel is supplying the actually neck and the head. Okay. Thirdly, when you come to the valve level of the valve, we can see yes, there's another thing is tubular hypoplasia is there, but in tubular hypoplasia, you'll find a same normal anterograde flow, right? And when you come to valves, it's basically AVSD, which is unbalanced AVSD, which might present with a small left ventricle as well. And cases, you might have a mitral stenosis with a VSD also, which might look like similar to that.
So it's basically very often the small left ventricle, which is often the clue to go right and look at the arches. So when you see a smaller ventricle, you're trying to say that we should go ahead and look at the aortic arch, and this is how you will probably decipher. So if you do, if you see a small left ventricle, which is moving well, but then we, when you look at the aortic arch and you see a contralateral shelf, it is a coarctation. If you see a small left ventricle, which is moving well, mitral valve is patent, you go up, look at the aortic arch. If you do not see the aortic arch and you see the vessels continuing in the neck, it's an interrupted aortic arch. If you again see a small left ventricle and you elongate the arch, the entire arch is hypoplastic. It is tubular hypoplasia. Thank you so very much, Dr. Partha, for the clarity.
Thank you.
Now, I would like to ask Dr. Satyajit, can HLHS develop later in pregnancy? This is a very pertinent question, because very often you do the scans early on. The fourth chamber looks fine. And when the patient comes to you in the third trimester, you suddenly start seeing an abnormal left ventricle. Could you just take us through this concept, please?
Yes, sir. First of all, I'd like to say, yes, this is possible. I'd like at the beginning, like in the first trimester scan, the HLHS can easily be diagnosed when there is a mitral atresia, but presence of four chambers in the first trimester does not necessarily rule out development of HLHS. I'll tell you why. Because sometimes there occurs mild aortic stenosis in the first trimester, which is difficult to pick up in the first trimester. It is also not easy to pick up in the second trimester. The reason being, the fourth chamber in mild aortic stenosis, it looks normal. The clinch to the diagnosis is the aorta and the dysplastic valve, and the flow across the aorta is called as turbulent flow and with a post-stenotic dilatations. So when the stenosis progresses further, leading to critical aortic stenosis, then what happens? The heart becomes enlarged, globular, and hypokinetic, along with some endocardial changes in the form of hyperechogenicity in the endocardium and the interventricular septum. One important, which is called the endocardial fibroelastosis. One important finding in the critical aortic stenosis is that there will be always antegrade flow in the aorta, which differentiates with the HLHS. But as the stenosis, and another thing is the systolic velocity across the valve, which will be more than 200, indicating that there is a significant increase in the velocity because of the dysplastic valves. As the stenosis progresses further, aortic atresia sets up, along with there will be dysplastic mitral valve leading to monophasic diastolic flow basically, thus leading to the development of HLHS. This is a condition which is sometimes termed as evolving HLHS.
So we understand this concept very well, that a mild aortic stenosis early on can actually progress, because as the aortic walls gets narrower and narrower, the left ventricle has to exert more pressure to push blood across it. In that process, it becomes dilated, it becomes globular, and eventually starts failing, and therefore becomes akinetic, and then over a period of time will shrink to form an HLHS. This is evolution of a valvular disease, and therefore when we do the normal second trimester anomaly scans, we cannot always pick up valvular abnormalities that we need to keep in mind. And therefore, when patients come to you for a routine scan in the third trimester, do look at the heart specifically to see whether there are any changes that you now see. So now that we know that the patient had a normal second trimester anomaly scan, we've gone into third trimester and we are seeing signs of aortic stenosis. So we have no choice but to follow up these patients. So when we follow up these patients, Dr. Ruhi, what are the signs of ventricular dysfunction that we know that can tell us that this condition is worsening?
On follow-up scan, on Doppler, as Dr. Satiji Chauhan had already mentioned, that the PSV can go up as high as to 200 or more. In follow-up scan, we may find it reduced across the aortic valve, which may be around 80 to 200, but then it may go down up to 80 also. And then we would also find aortic regurgitation.
Yeah. That's so when the velocity is very high, it's a stenosis. But as a high velocity starts dropping, means that we know that the ventricle is now becoming dyskinetic and dysfunctional. Yes. And that is a worsening scenario. So drop in velocities, again, is a poor prognostic indicator. Dr. Baitya, could you join? Can I see you? Can I hear you?
Yes.
Yeah, fine. I was finding it difficult to reach out to you. Dr. Baitya, now as an obstetrician, you see a patient, you've seen Dr. Ruby's case. She had one presentation where the fetus had generalized anasarca, generalized hydrops, and an HLHS, whereas other were subsequently just isolated HLHS. So when such patients come to you as a clinical obstetrician, how do you counsel them?
Okay, good evening, sir. Actually, it's a very difficult job for the obstetrician when you find a case of this kind of complex cardiac malformation. Mainly the reason behind is that the cause is not known. It mostly happens sporadically. And these are the patients has to be counseled, the couple, or also the family members. And counseling part, we should include that how to go about her antenatal care, and also about her immediately after the delivery, how to take care of the newborn, where they should go for a delivery, etc. So when you counsel this the people, and you should basically make them understand what is this complex heart disease about, and what are the complications they can face, the baby can face during ongoing pregnancy, and need for the ultrasonographic follow-up routinely as advised 4 to 6 weeks interval, to look for any complications or a poor prognostic factors that can be made out during the ultrasonography. Also, you should make them understand what is the relation between this kind of disease and genetic problems, because these are some group of patients may be associated with Turner syndrome or trisomy 13 and 18. So we might have to go for some testing like amniocentesis to confirm this diagnosis. Also, you have to look for other extra cardiac problems that have been discussed. But important thing, the scanning, when you do a routine scanning, ultrasonography, should try to find out this poor prognostic. That is, one is the dysfunctional tricuspid valve function, that is regurgitation, when you find regurgitation, and the flow across the foramen ovale, if there is a resistance, which is very high resistance foramen ovale, can be a poor prognostic factors for this newborn babies. One important thing is that is what we have to make them understand, they have to be placed where you have it all equipped center, you have a good neonatal backup, and you have a good neonatal cardiologist and operative interventions, because these babies require immediate operative interventions after the delivery within a few days. They may be quite fine immediately after birth, but within a few hours may have a complication. So they may be requiring some stage surgeries, 3-stage surgeries, which are very popular, no wood procedures, that is 3-stage surgeries. First surgeries has to be done within a few days, and then after a few months, and these 3-stage surgeries are very complex surgeries. You have to make them understand about the prognosis of this and difficulties of this procedure, because the survival following this surgery, if following stage 1 surgery, is up to 76%, and stage 2 and 3, it's up to 95%. Best possible way to manage this kind of complex cardiac problems by the cardiac transplant, which is probably not possible all the time, even though there is not much of data is available about the long-term follow up, but as we understand over the few years of last 15 years about this disease and its management, we see that they have difficulties in and the quality of life.
Yes.
Because significant morbidity has been seen, and those significant morbidity mostly associated with the thrombotic complications that leads to the stroke. Also, they are found to have the neurodevelopmental difficulties in those newborns. So all this has to be discussed while you are yes. kind of cases.
Common question that when we discuss the surgeries and the possible outcomes is what will be the quality of life? And all over the literature, you will find, as you rightly said, that the quality of life is poor and neurological outcomes are extremely poor. There's still study going on in it, but this doesn't seem to be a very feasible option. So obviously, if the patient chooses to terminate in the right time frame, you probably would go ahead with it, wouldn't you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Exactly, sir. I have come across two of them case, explained to them, they act in want to go through this process, and ultimately I have to terminate them, actually terminate the pregnancies.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Baidya. And we now, take this to the genetics level, and I invite Dr. Deka to, sort of shed some light as to what is the recurrence rate? Is there an inheritance pattern? Would you like to investigate a case of HLHS further by doing genetic testing? Over to you, sir.
Very good afternoon to everyone. Very good evening, Mother. And I, first of all, thank SFM for giving me this opportunity. Am I audible, Dr. Mohit?
Perfect, Dr. Deep.
Okay.
Please go on.
So I thank all of you at SFM for giving me this opportunity. Me being an anatomist, first of all, I would like to throw some light a little bit on the molecular regulation of cardiac development. See, at the very outset, near about the third week, what happens is certain transcription factors like BMP2 and 4 and they are secreted in the region where the heart has to develop. And certain other genes which are in play, like the WNT, et cetera, they are downregulated. And in combination of these two signals, another gene, which is this very crucial, the previous slide, may I have, please? Yeah. Another very crucial gene, that is the NKX2.5 and the TBX5, which are very crucial for cardiac development, is turned on. They are stimulated so that the heart starts developing. The next one, please. Next slide, please. Yeah, so proper expression of these genes are essential for the development of the heart. And it is seen that mutations in these expressions are associated with congenital heart diseases. Next, please. So to tell you whether it is inherited and if there is a pattern of inheritance or not, yes, it is inherited to some extent because studies show that. That is seen from statistics. But to tell you in one word, there is no set pattern of inheritance. For there are involvement of various genes which are there. Say, for example, the GJ1 gene, if this gene has undergone some mutation, then the inheritance pattern seen is autosomal recessive. The other way around, if mutations are in the NKX2.5 gene, the autosomal dominant inheritance pattern is seen. So mostly the cases that are seen are sporadic, as my fellow panelists have said. So we cannot just pinpoint one method for that. But recurrence, when we talk about it, yes, in case there is a history of an HLHS in the family, then that couple having another child with HLHS is about 1 in 3. So I think there is some point in doing a genetic diagnosis to pinpoint what is the exact problem there. Secondly, in case of sporadic cases, we don't know exactly what has happened, so we may go for whole genome sequencing, what has happened. Now, in syndromic cases, evaluation for the associated syndromes do help, because many a times, or rather most of the time, an HLHS is a feature of some other syndrome along with it. And the chromosomal anomaly studies are helpful in the second trimester of pregnancy. Otherwise, you go for a whole genome sequencing, which is not definitely always feasible. So to take the take home message is, we do not have one single test which is the diagnosis for HLHS.
If a patient chooses to do a genetic testing,
yeah,
we probably you recommend doing a whole genome sequencing, is it?
Most of the patients will refuse that too, maybe because of the cost involved.
Cost, yes, cost is quite prohibitive.
This is quite a big thing. Yeah. But amniocentesis do help to find out, because this genetic testing here is not, may not be helpful for that particular pregnancy per se, but genetic testing information that is available from there will help us to counsel the couple for their future pregnancy.
Okay. Okay, good. Thank you so much. For all the panelists, so I would just like to conclude that it has a poor prognosis, but it is the easiest anomaly to be detected because of the discrepancy in the four chamber of the heart, and therefore is easily picked up in most of the patients that you would find. Yes. But it's important that we pick it up early, and therefore, when we do a nuchal scan, we always do that cardiac color screen where we do see two parallel inflows. And that is crucial because we can actually, you know, counsel the patient and decide what needs to be done further. Thank you all for this wonderful panel, and I'm blessed.